Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When my enemies and my foes came to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though a host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord, and behold the beauty of the Lord, and inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion. In the secret place of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me upon a rock, and now shall my head be lifted up above my enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing praises unto the name of the Most High God. Truly, the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him. The Lord is my rock and my fortress. In him will I trust. The Lord is the helper of my soul. In him will I not be afraid. The blessings of the Lord fall upon us. On today, we've come to celebrate the life of Jimmie Lee Young, asking God's grace to be upon all of you today. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Again, we extend our condolences to the family. You are in our prayer and in our thoughts on today. Our service will flow as follows. At this time, we will have a solo by Charles Wilkerson, followed by the opening prayer by Miss Teresa.
Soon I will be done with the trouble of this world. Trouble of this world. Trouble of the world. Oh, soon I will be done with the trouble of this world. Trouble of this world. weeping and wailing, there'll be no more weeping and wailing. There'll be no more weeping and wailing. I'm going home to live, live with God. Woo! Soon I will be done with the trouble of this world.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I ask you to stand, if you would, while we pray. And my condolences to the family, to Brother Wicker, and to all his family. And I pray that the Lord will be with you at this time. So let us bow our heads and pray. Most holy and gracious Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. And we ask, O Lord, that you would be with us right now. Father, send your Holy Spirit. Lord, you know what each and every one of us need right now, Lord. And especially this family, Lord, as they are going through the loss of their loved one. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, that you would be with them and that you would comfort them. And meet them, Lord, in their area of need. And so, Father God, we just ask, oh, Lord, that you would send your Holy Spirit, fill us, Lord, so that we could do the things that you would have us to do. Now, today, dear Heavenly Father, as they're laying their loved one to rest, we ask for your presence. We ask for your power. We ask, dear Heavenly Father, for your comfort. And for you to comfort the way that you know that each and every individual needs. So, Father God, we ask, oh, Lord, that you will be with them through the worship service and through this homegoing service. And we pray, Lord, that you will comfort them now and even for the days ahead. Meet them spiritually, physically, emotionally, financially, in every way. And then, Lord, most of all, Lord, I know that anytime we come together to a time like this, Lord, there may be somebody that does not know you. But, Father God, I pray, dear Heavenly Father, that you will have us to have open ears and hearts so that we can hear what your Holy Spirit is saying, Lord. Because we're here today and we're gone tomorrow, and we have days that are going by so fast. And while they're going by so fast, we have trouble on every hand. But, Father God, I pray, dear Lord, that if there's anybody that does not know you in the pardon of their sin, if they don't know you, Lord, as Lord and Savior, Lord, I pray that when we get through this service, Lord, I pray to Heavenly Father that as you are working on their heart, that they'll say, you know, I need to make it right with the Lord. I need to make my calling and my election sure, because we're all going to pass this way. So, Father God, we pray, oh, Lord, you send your Holy Spirit, have your way, Lord. I pray, Father God, for the man of God that will bring the word. Father, that you will speak through him, to us, oh, God. Help us to hear. And then we pray, Lord, that we'll have everything that we need, that as we go out, Lord, that we'll go out, dear Heavenly Father, being comforted in the only way that you know that we can be comforted. We love you and we praise you and we give you the glory. Forgive us, Lord, of our sins. For you said, Lord, if we regard iniquity in our hearts, you won't hear us. But, Father, open up our ears so that we can hear. What do you want to say to us individually? We don't have to look to the right or to the left. But we ask, dear Heavenly Father, that you speak to each one. And we pray, dear Heavenly Father, that you will do what you want to do. And we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good afternoon. I would like to, before I read the scriptures, I would like to extend my condolences to the family. I know that this is a trying and a difficult time, but please be assured and know that the Lord will see you through. I will be reading for our Old Testament, Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Our New Testament scripture is found in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that it is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? Amen.
A life well lived. In love and memory of a man so dear, Jimmie Lee Young, we gather here. A life well lived with love and grace, we celebrate in this sacred place. From Houston's heart, he made his start. With strength and warmth, he played his part. A husband true to Linda's heart, together they were never apart. Though life is fleeting, love remains, and cherished memory, joy sustains. With daughter Loretta, his legacy lives on through time eternally. An engineer with passions wide, in antique shops, his joy did hide. Restoring treasures, sharing tales, a life enriched by love's details. Brothers, sisters, families dear, in every heart, he's always near. A smile, a laugh, a gentle hand, in our minds forever will stand. In Yolanda's love, he found delight in late years' glow so warm and bright. A testament to life's sweet song in every heart where he belongs. With God above, he now resides in heavenly peace. His soul abides. We trust in him who guides our way to reunite us all one day. Jimmie, you will be deeply missed by every soul your life has kissed. In heaven's arm, you find your rest. Among the angels, you are blessed. We hold you close in memory's embrace, your spirit, love, and endless grace. Forever etched within our hearts, in peace, Dear Jimmie, you now depart.
Amen. At this time, we'll have a special music presentation by Brother Charles Wilkerson.
Get my mansion ready. Oh, angel, turn back my bed. Oh, because I know that Jesus, He's gonna make up my dying bed. Oh, angel, I've got these tears all in my final notice. I've got to move to the other side. Oh, right now I'm waiting. Yeah, for Jesus to call me. And just to look out for me. Down here is finished. Yeah, I'm going on with you. Yeah. Angel, I've got these tears all in my eyes. I've got my final notice. Got to move to the other side. Oh, right now, I'm waiting. I'm waiting. Say, I'm waiting. Yeah, for Jesus to call me. And then,
this time, I will read the obituary in your hearing. Jimmie Lee Young, age 74, passed away peacefully on July 14, 2024. Born on January 6, 1950, in Houston, Texas, to his proud mother, Bertha Young, Jimmie lived a life full of love, adventure, and dedication to his family and friends. Jimmie was the devoted husband of the late Linda Dernice Young, who passed away on September 6, 2015. Jimmie and Linda were high school sweethearts and were married on April 28, 1973. They shared 43 wonderful years filled with love and companionship until her passing. Although Jimmie and Linda had no children together, Jimmie is survived by his beloved daughter, Loretta Sams. He was a cherished figure to many, including his brothers, Curview Wicker Jr. of Colorado and Hence Wicker of Houston, Texas. Jimmie was preceded in death by his brother, Leroy Wicker of Houston, Texas, Alfred Wicker of Troy, Ohio, and his sister, Odelia Ogburn of Houston, Texas. He also leaves behind his sister-in-law, Faye Willie and Barbara Mormon, as well as brother-in-law, Billy Joe Phillips. Additionally, he is survived by a host of nieces, including Bertha, Loretta, Laverne, and Eileen. Nephews, including Hence Wicker Jr. and Leroy Wicker Jr. Cousins, a grandchild, and many friends who will all miss him dearly. After the passing of his wife, Jimmie did not remarry, but he shared a special relationship with his girlfriend, Yolanda Dennis, who was a significant part of his life in his later years. Throughout his life, Jimmie was known for his passion for engineering and antiquing. He loved exploring antique shops and markets, always on the lookout for hidden treasures. Jimmie took great joy in restoring and selling his findings, sharing his love for history and craftsmanship with others. He was also dedicated to his career as an engineer and was actively involved in the community. Jimmie touched many lives with his warm spirit and always had a smile and kind words for everyone he met. Jimmie will be deeply missed by all who had the privilege of knowing him. His spirit, love, and memories will remain in our hearts forever. Thank you.
At this time, we'll have special music before we have our expressions and reflections.
Good morning, church. Good morning, family. The song that we are about to minister to you all is My Help. Last couple of months, been around Jimmie, Uncle Jimmie, I had assurance that he knew that his life was in the Master's hand. So please pray with us as we minister to you. And remember that your help cometh from the Lord.
Amen.
The Lord which made heaven. He said, he will not suffer thy foot to be moved. The Lord which keepeth thee, he will not slumber nor sleep. Oh, the Lord is thy keeper, the Lord is thy shade upon thy right hand, upon thy right hand. Nor the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon by night. He shall preserve my soul even forevermore. My help, my help, my help, all of my help cometh from the
to the hills from whence cometh my help. The Bible says, my help cometh from the Lord. Amen. At this time, we will have expressions and reflections from family and friends who would like to, if you just come down front here. We ask you if you would just be so mindful to keep your reflections within the two-minute time period that the family has asked. But we definitely want to give you an opportunity to speak about your friendship, your relationship with Brother Young.
Hello. Oh, glory. Yule, and I am Diane Yule's daughter. And so 9 years ago, I stood up here when my Aunt Linda passed and thanked my Uncle Jimmie for restoring what some of us has lost of a love of a marriage. And so those two really just, you know, embraced me when I moved here. And they were always talking about, you know, they grew up together. So Reynolds and Woodson and Worthing. And so he was always telling me about him and my mom's adventure to these yard sales to find antiques and to restore stuff. And so it was really hard to hear when he started to get sick. And so I just want to say thank you for all that have been there for him.
Hello, I'm Michael Ogburn. Jimmie was my uncle. I miss playing chess with him already. I remember the first time I won, beat Uncle Jimmie. I thought I was bad. But we never got the chance to do it again. Miss you, Uncle. Love you, Uncle.
Any others would like an opportunity to speak, please come now.
Given unto the God, I'd like to thank everybody who came, because Jimmie, he was a way maker for me, him and Linda. Me and Linda went to college together, but when we had things to do, she said, come on, girl, got to go, and got Jimmie at work, but I got to take him some food. I mean, it was just a joy. When I had problems, they came to me. When I didn't have nobody else, Linda said, come on, Elma, need us. He was there. He was a person you could depend on no matter what. If he could fix it, it got fixed. If he can do it, he would do it. He introduced me to my husband I have now. And you talk about a God bless, I was blessed. Because when them two put us together, she said, oh, girl, come on now. You got to come and get with this man because he was a good woman. And thank God he gave me a good man. All right. Those two knew how to put you where you need to be. And I have to thank Jimmie and Linda for being trustworthy friends that gave me what I needed when I needed. And God bless him. And he's going to a better place. Yes,
all right. Good morning, everyone. So I'm Kamika Phillips Scott. I am Linda's eldest, most favorite niece. So Jimmie was one of my favorite uncles. I'm sitting there and I'm just thinking about all the memories of my uncle. And I remember being a little girl when he used to pick me up in that red Toyota truck he used to have. And he would take me to my aunt school when she went to HCC. And I would sit in the truck and wait for my aunt to finish her lessons. And they were getting the truck, and they would try to talk pig Latin in front of me. Like, I couldn't pick it up when I was, like, 7 years old. And so I picked up what they were saying, and my uncle started laughing. He was like, that girl's smart. My uncle taught me about computers, Thanksgivings. We always did Pac-Man. I have so many great memories of my uncle. All the antiquing, he done rubbed that off on me. Now my house is full of antiques. So many great memories. And one thing I just told my husband, I totally forgot. My daughter's 9, and she died. My Aunt Linda died when my daughter was right around 9 months. And I remember being my daughter's age and saying, when I get older, I want to marry a man like my Uncle Jimmie, because he could fix and do anything. And by God, did I not receive that. So I'm so thankful for the man that he was and for the mentorship that he gave me with his strong yet quiet spirit. That's one thing I will always remember about him. He was a wonderful man. Anyone that knew him, he was a joy to be around. So I love him, and I will always miss him.
Thank you. Anyone else before we move to our resolutions and acknowledgments? Sister Gregory. After Sister Gregory, we will have a special tribute by friend Jonathan, and then the eulogy by Pastor Samuels, and then a solo by Lannis Douglas.
Good morning. I'm Rosenda Gregory. I am the church clerk and the church administrative assistant here at World Harvest Outreach. We welcome you all here, not just for this, but come and visit with us again when you can. Faith and power go hand in hand. Always pursue what is good, both for yourselves and for all. 1 Thessalonians 5:15. We, the members of the World Harvest Outreach Seventh-day Adventist Church family, bow our heads in humble submission to the will of the Almighty God in the passing of Jimmie L. Young, the brother of Deacon Hence Wicker. In his death, we have lost a man who was struggling for his life, trying to fight off one of the most terrifying diseases a person may encounter. We give our condolences to his brother, Hence, and the entire family. There is no question that life is difficult and uncertain. In the blink of an eye, the life can come crashing down around us like a lightning strike of brimstone. Whether these crises come at a bedside, a graveside, a roadside, or in a marriage, a relationship, an office, or a church setting, the results can leave us as devastated, weak-kneed, and shattered. These are the moments faith is made of. The Bible supports this, and it has been seen many times in our own lives and in others. The more we need faith, the more faith we are given. The more we completely trust God, the deeper that trust grows. Faith and power are gifts that go hand in hand, and they come from the source of power, the Holy Spirit. God's gifts of faith and power are always adequate, no matter how desperate a situation has become. This is the resolution for the family of Jimmie L. Long. So let it be resolved this, the 19th day of July, 2024, that the church family shares in your sorrow, but when God is with us, it is enough. Let it further be resolved this, the 19th day of July, 2024, that we will continue to pray for your family and with them. We encourage all of you to stay on the path to a destination we all long for, and at the end of that path, you will surely find God. Lovingly submitted in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, Pastor Alex Royez, our senior pastor, World Harvest Outreach Seventh-day Adventist Church. The family of Jimmie Lee Young wishes to express their deepest gratitude for the love and support during this difficult time. Your kindness and prayers have been a source of comfort and strength for them. Thank you.
Thank you. When you're lonely and your heart is filled with despair, remember God cares.
God cares for you.
And when you're in doubt and you can't find your way out, remember He'll see you through. Yes, He will.
See you through. See you through.
Just
call on the name of
Somebody ought to say hallelujah. How precious, how precious, how precious, how precious is the name of Jesus. Somebody ought to shout Jesus again. His name is precious. There's power in that name. And even in this place today, what a joy to be reminded that there is power in that name. Thank you, family, for reminding us that Jesus cares. When our hearts are broken, and when life comes against us, and when the trials and difficulties come, we can lean on Jesus because he cares. I'm not wearing my glasses, but I was really looking carefully. Was that Jonathan? I've known Jonathan for 3 years. And I know Jonathan can dance. I know he can get down. But I didn't know that he was so multi-gifted and talented. Put your hands together. Put your hands together even now. We thank God for his goodness. And I want to say to you, family, on behalf of my wife, Rhonda, and our sons, Zachary and Jeremy, we certainly want to extend again to you our condolences. We know that God is with you. He has been with you. When Deacon Wicker called Pastor Royce, you can't say no to Deacon Wicker. He is, without a shadow of a doubt, one of the kindest persons that I know. He is indeed an angel, man of God. Doesn't say much, but he gives a whole lot. And we want to thank God for you, Deacon Wicker, and family. Certainly, just want to thank God for the few occasions I had to visit with your brother, Jimmie. In fact, I recall the first time I visited with him, he kept talking about AC. And I didn't know who AC was. And so we were talking, he was talking about AC, and then he realized I was a bit confused. And so he expressed to me that AC is hence. And I want to tell you, and every time when we spoke together, he has a great admiration for you. He's expressed that in several ways. He looked up to you, and we thank God for the life that he lived. And so, family, I want to share with you, not a lengthy time with you together, but I do want to share with you just very quickly a word from the Lord that I prayed that would bring some measure of comfort to your heart. I want to thank my colleague in ministry, my brother in Christ, Pastor Alex Royce, for allowing me the privilege to be able to share today with the family. And so, family, I want to pray with you as we open the Word of God together to find comfort from God. Loving Father, there is power in that name. There is just something about the name of Jesus. And so because, God, there is power in the name of Jesus, I do ask, oh God, that for the few moments that I will stand before your children, would you hide me behind the cross of Jesus? And let only Jesus be heard and seen and lifted up, that he will bring comfort to his brokenhearted children. It is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I want to confess to you, family, that at moments like this, we speak not to the dead, but we do speak to the living. The Bible declares, children of God, that the living know that they would die, but the dead knows nothing. And so for the few minutes that I have to share with you, I want to speak to you a word from the Word of God that perhaps would bring you some joy, some comfort, some hope in this your time of sorrow and bereavement. Perhaps I've heard it read just on today several times, the 23rd Psalm. The 23rd Psalm is, without doubt, perhaps I'm told, the most memorized psalm. It is the most quoted psalm. It is the most cherished piece of scripture in the entire world, perhaps everyone knows something about the 23rd Psalm. It was used quite often. It is used quite often to bring some measure of strength and hope and comfort and solace to men and women in times of great trial and adversity. The 23rd Psalm is used by people in all across the centuries to bring them hope and courage that they can find when it's needed most. I don't have the time to go through the entire psalm today, but I want to just highlight one verse. In fact, I would suspect that if I did a survey, if I went through the congregation today and asked you something about the 23rd Psalm, people who are believers and non-believers, people who are skeptics and atheists, people who are Christians and non-Christian, I am sure they will be able to share with me something from the 23rd Psalm. Somebody would be able to tell me that the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. It's very well known. But today I just want to highlight just for a moment, just a little phrase from the fourth verse of that psalm. It says simply that the fourth verse says that, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. Have you heard that before? Not only is the Lord your shepherd, but the psalmist declares in this verse, he said, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. In other words, he wanted us to know, as we wanted to know today, that the Lord who is his shepherd is a God who is willing to come near and to walk with us in the most difficult, discouraging, tough, hard, burdensome moments of life. We find that this God who is our shepherd, he walks with us when death comes into the life, as death always would show up and uninvited. He wanted us to know that in moments like this, that the shepherd is with us in the valley of death. I want to remind your family right there that the truth of the matter is that we live in a world that has been touched and tainted by sin. And because sin is in this world, the reality is that all of us in some way would be experience the harm, the power that death brings into our life. There is none of us who would be able to flee away from death. No matter what you do, no matter how hard you try, death remains a reality to every family. Every person at some point would experience death in some way. Now, the truth of the matter, it may not be your own death. Even though if you keep on living, that will come. But there is not a person, I suspect, in this audience, this congregation today, who can say, Pastor, I've never had to deal with death. I've always avoided death, because the truth of the matter, saints of God, there is absolutely no way that we can circumnavigate this thing called death. You have heard of the story of a man who heard that death was looking for him. He was in his town. Let's say he was in Houston. He heard through the grapevine. He heard and saw on the internet and the social media platform that death was trying to find him. And so he decided that he would avoid death. He would escape death. He would run away from death. And so he decided that I'm going to leave Houston. Houston is a big city, but death can find me in Houston. And so he found a little village somewhere out in Louisiana that he can hide out, a little town. Somewhere, a little rural community, a country town, and he figured, if I can escape from Houston, death cannot find me. But death, being wise and shrewd, showed up at his house. Knock on the door. His wife answered and opened. And his wife knew that he had left to escape death. And death came knocking. And death said to the wife, I came looking for whatever the man's name was. And the wife said, well, you missed him. He's not here. He went to whatever the town in Louisiana was. And death said, I am glad. I thought he was still in Houston, but I have an appointment with him in that little country town somewhere. In other words, there's absolutely nothing you can do to avoid death. Death is not a respecter of person. Death, that grim reaper, death, that unwelcome guest, death, that person would show up at any moment. You cannot invite death. You cannot escape death at any time. The truth of the matter is that the fear of death has always been present with mankind since the fall of Adam and Eve. Since the moment that Adam and Eve fell, men have done everything to pursue life without being tainted and touched by death. Every culture, every history have something that they have done in order to try to escape death. But the truth of the matter today, saints of God, though we are here between the living and the dead, I want to show you that death transcends all cultures, all history. The ancient pharaohs would bury their dead with preparation for the possibility that there was an afterlife. They wanted to find this remedy to death. In fact, told that Ponce de Leon wanted to escape death. He traversed what is now Florida, exploring that territory, just trying to find what he called the fountain of youth. He wanted to live forever. He wanted to beat death. He wanted to escape death. But even in his quest to escape death, he would die at the tip of a spear. In other words, we can never escape death. The ancient alchemists wanted to come up with concoctions and invention and fraudulent formulas in order to find ways that they can beat death, but they all failed. I'm trying to tell somebody that even in our time, even now, there are those who would tell us that we can communicate with the dead, and the dead are not really dead. And even when you pass from this life, you pass into another life, and somehow you can escape death. They would tell you that even when your loved one die, that they are in a better place. But can I tell the truth, somebody? Death is not a better place. Death is a bitter place. If death was such a better place, let me see the hands of those who want to die right now. It's amazing that we all says that death is a better place. We look at the demise of our loved ones and we say, yes, he is in a better place. Yes, she is in a better place. But none of us want to go to that better place. The truth of the matter, I am a preacher of the gospel. I believe in the power of the gospel to save. I believe that Jesus has gone to prepare a place for me. But the truth of the matter, Brother Eli, I have no plans to die anytime soon. I know that the time will come. I know that death is a reality, but I'm not making plans to die anytime soon. Recently, I was out in Baytown, and we had a funeral, and after we were out at the committal at the cemetery, one of the members came and said, Pastor, I want to show you some of your members. I thought he was going to show me someone who had attended the funeral. He walked me over to a grave site, and there on the headstone, he said, Pastor, these are some of your members. There were pictures, there were names, and I thought that he was trying to tell me that there are some members who were buried in that grave. But when I looked at the headstone very carefully, they had pictures, they had names, they had the date that they were born, they had the dash, but there was no final date. Some people are so brave to deal with death that they went all the way and they made preparation and readiness. They bought their grave. They bought their headstone. They took pictures to put on their headstone. They put their names. They put the date in when they were born, Dr. Bullock. But I want to tell somebody, I don't know if I'm that brave. I don't mind preparing for my family. I don't mind getting the insurance plan, Demani. But I don't know if I'm going out to any cemetery to put my picture and my name and date that I was born, waiting for the date that I die. I say, thank you, Jesus. I will just wait. I'll leave that assignment to somebody else. But the truth of the matter is that you can prepare for death as much as you want. But here is what the word of God, the Bible says, Hebrews 9:27. It is appointed unto man, man wants to die, and after that, the judgment. In other words, the word of God is saying, hey, you got an appointment with death. That's the reality that we face today. Even as we are funeralizing today, Brother Jimmie, we the truth of the matter is that each and every one of us have an appointment with death. And the truth of the matter, saints of God, it is an appointment that you can't escape. You don't have the privilege to delete it. You don't have the privilege to reschedule it. Yes, you can go on a diet. You can eat the best food. You can get the best healthcare coverage. You can see the best doctor. You can find the best cure. But the truth of the matter is, it doesn't matter what you do. The Bible says that the wages of sin is death. And because we are living in a world touched and tainted by sin, the reality is that all of us at some point would die. That's why the psalmist in Psalm 146, 46 verse 4 says that, speaking of man, he said he his breath goes forth, he returned to the earth no more. In that day his very thought perish. In other words, the truth of the matter, saints of God, is that all of us would come to that place. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 5 says, "For the living know that they shall die, but the dead knows not anything, neither have they any more a reward, for a memory of them is forgotten. Also their love and their hatred, their envy now perish, neither have they any more a portion forever in anything that is under the sun." All this mess that we deal with in our country, all the strife that we deal with in our family. The Bible said that not only will the man die, not only will the woman die, but all the mess, all the confusion, all the stuff that we deal with, even that will perish. And so we might as well, if it's going to perish, we might as well live at peace with each other. For the truth of the matter, the preacher came by as we funeralize our dear beloved one to tell you, saints of God, one of these days you will die. That's not the message Deacon Wicker invited me to speak. But it's sad, but it's the truth. Because Isaiah says, "For the grave cannot praise thee, nor death cannot celebrate thee. They that go down into the pit cannot have hope for thy truth." And so the truth of the matter, saints of God, if we all know that we're going to die, what hope do we have? What is the good news in all of this? We just left alone with no hope at all. Truth of the matter, saints of God, I want to share with you, though it's the sad truth that we're all going to die. The Bible says the wages is sin, sin is death, but there is a gift of God and it's eternal life. Paul says in Romans 5:12, "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered the world and death by sin, so death pass upon all men, for all have sinned." That's include you, that's including me and all of us. But the truth of the matter, beloved, that is not the final word. David picks up on this. David recognized this in the psalm. When he recognized that not only is God his shepherd, but he had this personal connection, this first-hand knowledge of Scripture. I believe that he had read the Word of God. He knew, was intimately acquainted with the book of Job, and he knew the suffering that Job faced, and he recognized that though death is a reality, there is a greater hope for mankind than the reality of death itself. And so being acquainted with the wealth of knowledge from Job's experience, that man who was bruised and burned and bent down and broken, being reflected on his own death, Job recognized that death is imminent in the life of men, even the righteous people, that Job declared, "Man who is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble. He comes forth like a flower and fades away. He flees like a shadow and does not continue. But man dies and is laid away." That's the Bible, saints of God. "Indeed, he breathes his last. And where is he?" Job asks. "As the water disappears from the sea and river becomes parched and dries up, so man lies down and does not rise till the heavens are no more. They will not awake nor be roused from their sleep. Oh, that you would hide me," Job cried, "from the grave, that you will conceal me until the rod is past, the rod of death is past, that you would appoint for me a set time," he says to God, "and remember me." And then Job, brother Eli, he asks a pertinent question. Job asks this question that I want you to consider today. He asks this question when confronted with death, losing his children, losing his possession. Death is all around him. Job had one question. If a man died, if a woman dies, if a person dies, shall he live again? It's a question of the day. Is this the end? Is this all that we have? Job raised this question. He lifted up this question. He looked at this question. And this is not a question from a man who is scornfully crying out to God. This is not a question from a man without faith. But this is rather a question that is framed in the mind and the intellect of a man who is appealing to the wisdom of God. He forms this question recognizing that maybe he doesn't know the answer, but he knows the one who has all the answers. And he asks this question that flows from the experience of his own life. When he looked at his children and he looked at everything he had lost, if a man dies, shall he live again? And I want to tell you, family, you are to contemplate the truth of that question. If you die, and when you die, can you live again? Job was not asking just because he did not believe, but I believe Job was asking because he understood that God had all the answers and God knew the answer. He said, if a man die, would he live again? And here's what I want to remind you, family of God. Though the wages of sin is death, it's guaranteed it will come. That little word, but, changes everything. That word, but, reminds us that, yes, weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. You got to deal with that word, but. Job said, if a man dies, shall he live again? All the days of my hard service, I will wait until my change comes. But changes everything. Yes, we will die, but there is a but that brings glory. There is a but that brings hope. There is a but that brings a second chance with God. There is a but that says, hey, we will die because of sin in the world and sin in the life, but we can turn to God because God inserted that but in the equation to let us know that even though death comes, this terrible thing called death, there is hope. If a man dies, will he live again? But the gift of God is eternal life. Ah, you're not getting the preacher. You know, you detect that I have a little accent. You detect I have a little accent. Because I'm from a place when there is debt, the money, people really cry. You know, they're the Sylvester, they are not sophisticated like us here. When they get news that someone dies, we say they bawl. They don't just cry. And I remember one time there was an accident and a few people died, and this one sister, she got word that her son was in that vehicle that had overturned, and someone came and they told her that her son was in the vehicle, and then she did what many of the ladies back then and perhaps now would do. They start bawling, Elder Glasgow, and when I say bawling, I mean the messy kind of stuff. They don't have time to make sure that it's a cute crying where you're crying but you're fixing the makeup. You're crying but you got to make sure that the lashes are on right. You're crying but you got to make sure that the mascara is not messed up. You're crying, but you got to make sure that your dress is on right. I mean, they get really downright ugly crying. And so when this lady heard that her son was in that vehicle that had overturned, she did the stuff that the ladies did. She started pulling out her hair, lifting up her clothes, and really start getting messy and crying. But the person who brought the news, as she started crying, the person said, yes, your son was in the vehicle, but... And in the midst of that ugly mess of crying, when she heard that word, but, she stopped crying immediately, because she knew that if he was in the vehicle and she heard news that people had died, but when it came to the reference to her son, there is a but. She knew something good was coming. And I want to tell you, saints of the living God, yes, we will have to deal with death. Yes, we will be disappointed. Yes, we will be discouraged. Yes, life will be difficult. But the truth of the matter is that Job, while he asked the question, he asked it not just because he didn't know the answer, but Job very well knew the answer. Job wanted to raise the question because he wanted it to be a rhetorical question for you to answer today, because Job would later declare himself in Job 19:25, for I know. I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at the latter day. And though my skin worms destroy my body, he says, but. In other words, Job is saying, listen, I'm going to die. Worms are going to eat this body. One day would be my final day. I would rest with my children. I rest with my ancestors, my father. But he said, Job said, because I know the one who is my Redeemer, he said, I can deal with death. But when I deal with death, I can face death with a but. Don't need to be afraid. Just got to realize, just hold on. David says, the Lord is my shepherd. The reason why he exclaimed, the Lord is my shepherd, and the reason why he can deal with death with a strong encouragement is that he knew that the Lord is my shepherd, and that's a statement of relationship. You can only say that if the Lord is your shepherd. You can only say, though you walk through the valley of the shadow of death, you will fear no evil, if you have the relationship with the one who has walked through death and can walk with you through death. He says, the Lord is my shepherd, and though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because my Redeemer is with me. Yeah, yeah, There's good news for the believer, even in death. There's good news for the one who is not afraid of death. And so David, as he contemplates his own demise, his own mortality, he's able to face death not just with discouragement. He faced death not just being heartbroken. He faced death not just being overwhelmed. He faced death with a yedo cry. And the truth of the matter, saints of God, what I want to give you today is the reality that you too can face death so long as you know who the Redeemer is. You have to be able to be like David with the reality that you will die. You will face that your loved ones would die. That's not bad news, because you can leave this place today and say, yes, Pastor, I hear you. The living will die. I will die. My loved one will die. But when I leave this place today, it's not just with a sad reality of death, but I leave this place today with a shout of, yeah, though I may die. Yeah, though I may cry. Yeah, though I may fall. Yeah, though I may hurt. Yeah, though I may experience the power of death, I know that my Redeemer lives. Yes, so I'm going to just wait. No, family, the kings of this world who are named and famed and proclaimed and acclaimed with all the wealth and riches that they had, they're dead. But the King Jesus, not an ordinary king. Every other king died. But there's something about this Jesus why we find power in his name. Elvis Presley, the king of rock and roll, is dead. Michael Jackson, the king of pop, is dead. Bernie Mac, somebody told me, the king of comedy, is dead. James Brown, the king of soul, is dead. But Jesus, our king, Jesus, your king, Jesus, the one who died but yet conquered death, that Jesus, he ever lives. And because he lived, you too can live. I want to leave you with this, family. Every time Jesus confronted death, Jesus won. You know, when Jesus came to this earth, it seems, Pastor Royce, that he came precisely to deal with death. In fact, death was so much on the tail of Jesus that death showed up in the wilderness of temptation, and he tried to get Jesus to jump off the cliff, perhaps to end his life. But Jesus said, I'm not that foolish. And death wasn't satisfied with that. But Jesus would encounter death several times again. The first time was a daughter of a man named Jairus. And when Jairus' daughter died, death said, well, he can escape it, but let me see how he's going to deal with the dying of this young girl. But even though she died, by the time Jesus got there, Jesus was able to bring her back. That's one for Jesus and zero for death. Another time, there was a woman, a widow of Nain, and death is smart. Death said, hey, the last time he showed up at the house, but I'm going to take the boy out of the house. I'm going to take him all the way to the cemetery. Because if you take him out of the house, it's too late for Jesus. But the Bible said Jesus showed up even at the gate to the cemetery. And Jesus just said a word, just touched the boy. And again, it's two for Jesus and zero for death. Then there is Lazarus. I believe that say, hey, I got to up this thing. In the house, he can do it. In the cemetery, he can do it. But let me see what would happen if I allow the dead one to be dead for several days. It's too long gone. It's too far gone. There's absolutely nothing Jesus can do now. And so even though he was late, even though Lazarus' body has been decomposing for several days, when Jesus, the life giver, shows up, it's three for Jesus and zero for death. But your Bible reader, you know the rest of the story. That say, well, in the house, he can do it. In the cemetery, he can do it. From the grave, he can pull him. But what would happen if you kill the life giver? If the one who can raise and resurrect the dead, what would happen if he dies? And so death took Jesus, hang him on a cross, The Bible said he hung his head and there he died. And death said, now I've got him. They laid him in a tomb. But you know the problem with that, Pastor Royce? It was a borrowed tomb. Jesus would owe nobody anything. And if you put him in a borrowed tomb, he knows that he has to return it. Because he is not one who borrows things and keep it. And they made a mistake, they put him in a borrowed tomb. And Jesus said, hey, this is not my tomb. I don't belong here. I got to give this thing back. And so the Bible said, no, he kept the Sabbath early Sunday morning. Jesus had to return the borrowed tomb. And saints of God, I want to tell you today, no grave has been made to keep you. No tomb can hold you. Because Jesus said, I went to prepare a place for you. Yes, death will come. Yes, we'll have hardship. Yes, we'll have trial. Yes, we'll have to come and funeralize our loved one like we're doing with Brother Jimmie today. But Jesus said, hey, if you die, when that time comes, you know the life giver. So family, I want to encourage you. When you leave here today, you got to leave with a yedo shout. Yes, I'm going to walk through the valley of the shadow of death, but I'm not going to fear evil because Jesus is with me. Jesus is with you. And if you face death, when you face death, be of good courage because a life giver will come and say, blessed are those who die in the Lord. For they shall only for a moment rest from their labor. May the Lord bless your family as you leave with the reality that death is not final because Jesus has made it so. Bless you.
To trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, and just to rest upon his promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. And Jesus, how I trust you, and how I prove you o'er and Jesus, my precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him more. And I'm so glad I've learned to trust him, precious Jesus, my Savior and friend. And I know that thou art with me. He'll be with me till the end. And Jesus, how I trust you, and how I prove you over and over. Jesus, my precious Jesus, oh, for grace trust him more. And Jesus, Jesus, how I trust you and how I prove you over. Jesus, oh, for grace, oh, for grace, oh, for grace, yes, Lord, oh, for grace, oh, for grace, to trust you more.
Oh, for grace to trust him more. I'm going to invite a congregation. Family, you may remain seated. Invite a congregation if you'll stand with me for our benediction. Shall we pray? It is so good to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know thus saith the Lord. Our Heavenly Father and our God, we thank you, Lord, today for the reminder that the word of God can be trusted. Thank you for reminding us, Lord, that even when the trouble and trial of death enters, that we have a God who cares. Father, today we are grateful that we have one, Jesus Christ, our high priest, the one who's touched with the very feelings of our infirmity. And so, Father, in a very special way, we ask God that you take this family. Help them to know, Lord, that this is not the end, that you are still in control, that you have all the issues of life in your hands. And you would take care of each and every one of us. And so, Father, again, we place this family before you. Continue, Lord, to be present in their life. Remind them, God, that in the days and weeks and months and even years ahead, when Brother Jimmie is missing, that Jesus will be with them. And so, Father, again, we ask that your grace, your mercy, your love will continue to flow in their hearts. I pray, Heavenly Father, that in this season you bring them together with you and with each other, and bless them in a mighty heavenly way, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. This time we want to invite our funeral directors, if you come from the Eternal Rest Funeral Home, and give us some instruction concerning the final destination, the final resting place of our dear beloved brother Jimmie Lee Young.
I shall